Behind me is the St Lawrence Seaway, one of the largest public works projects in North America's history. The Seaway was a 1950s expansion of small canals and waterways into a huge navigable path for shipping between the Atlantic and the Great Lakes, along with massive hydroelectric power plants. That expansion came at a cost though. The water is high today, but when it's low, you can still see the foundations of Aultsville, Ontario, one of the lost villages that were flooded to make way for progress. The residents were told that they had to move and see their old town demolished and then drowned beneath new, higher water. They didn't really have any choice in the matter. And then some scientists came along and said, if these homes are going to be demolished and then flooded anyway, can we set them on fire first?
The St. Lawrence Burns was a project where they were trying to study how fires develop in buildings, specifically how it affects the survival of the occupants, as well as how fire spreads from one building to another. The researchers were scientists from the Building Research Division of the National Research Council of Canada. They burned a total of 8 buildings, including 6 single-family dwelling homes, 1 two-story school, and 1 community hall. This was a rare opportunity because up until this point, most of the research that was done on fires were either from the aftermaths of real fires or they did it on small-scale lab tests. The St. Lawrence Burns was really the first time that scientists were able to conduct in-field, full-scale research where they had control over the parameters as well as being able to observe the fire from beginning to end.
There's a fair argument that if the buildings were going to be destroyed anyway, why not take the opportunity to get useful data from them? Whether it's by fire or by water, the result was going to be the same. But it's also tough to ignore the human element. Homes that had been in families for generations, the local school, the community hall, all given a sort of insult to injury by folks coming in from outside for science. Many people weren't even told about the burns, others chose not to watch. The volunteer fire chief said in an interview years later that watching the flames was devastating. But the results were probably worth it.
They got a lot of different data, including things like carbon monoxide concentration, smoke density, rise of temperature, oxygen levels. They mounted a microphone in the bedroom. They found out that the noise levels that was produced by a fire was not enough to wake a sleeping occupant when the bedroom door is closed. The assumption prior to the studies was that convection was the biggest cause of fire spread, but then it turns out it was actually radiant heat that was more likely the culprit. A combustible wood frame house could lead to another house 40 feet away to ignite. And even in a non-combustible building, it could cause another house about 32 feet away to ignite. The St. Lawrence Burns helped change the National Building Code of Canada, and it saved lives.
Aultsville has almost passed out of living memory today. On aerial photos, you can still see ghosts of old roads, structures that haven't been worn away by the water yet. But you could say there's a little bit of Aultsville in every modern home, in everything that's been built in the developed world from the 1960s onwards, because the results from the St. Lawrence Burns here really did change the way that everything was built.
Thank you very much to Betty Chen from Articulations,
where I do videos about art and design.
You'll want to go and check out her video about the ISO standard exit sign. It's not all science and infrastructure like here, but it is a great little channel. Little?
Oh, that's fine. It's pretty little.